Arno says, could you say hello world for us?
Hello world.
Fantastic. Did the dominant linguistic theories of the time consciously or unconsciously influence the design of certain programming languages?
I suspect the answer is yes, in some ways. I'm not sure that I'm enough of a historian to know for sure, but for example, languages like C derived from languages like, in particular, BCPL, which of course were influenced, sometimes positively, sometimes in a sort of reactionary way to ALGOL, which was really, really fundamental, but also to Fortran, which was, I would say, less theoretical in every respect, but very much more pragmatic in a way. So things are influenced by what went before, and sometimes it's a, wow, we need more of that, and sometimes it's a, we need less of that and do something different. So those would be examples. C++ would be another one influenced by the wonderful engineering that went into C, efficiency, obvious mechanisms, and so on, but at the same time taking what came from Simula, the idea of classes in particular. Simula is a language that I think didn't get the recognition that it did. When Nygaard got the Turing Award for it, that was recognition finally. But C++ clearly influenced by those two streams coming together. More modern example, Go, which the pragmatic part of it, the syntax, the minimalism and so on, very strongly influenced by C. But on the other side, the module structure influenced by all of the things that came from ALGOL through Klaus Wirth, Pascal Modula, Oberon, all of those things. And then the communicating sequential processes work of Tony Hoare. So those three streams come together. And certainly Tony Hoare's view of this was, well, let's call it a theoretical approach. So all of these things come together. So it's not like things come full-blown from the head of Zeus. They are based on what has gone before.
I've got a few people saying just pass on thank you. So thank you.
Thank you all.
What are your thoughts on writing secure by design software in C today? Is it better as a result for inexperienced programmers to use something higher level, something else?
I think writing secure software, you should do it by design. If you don't glue it on afterwards, that won't work. You have to think very carefully about what you do. I think the problem with C is that the language itself doesn't provide you with many mechanisms for making sure that your code is secure. So there's lots of ways in which you can inadvertently make a mistake and the compiler is not able to help you. And so for many purposes, a higher level language would probably be wiser because some of the array overflow is an obvious example. That's a buffer overrun is one of the common things that goes wrong with C programs. It doesn't go wrong, at least in that sense, with any language which is manipulating strings or arrays for you and keeping track of the bounds of them. So it's possible to screw up in any language, absolutely. But I think C is, by design, a very, very sharp tool, and you can cut yourself as well as cutting through things.
Tabs or spaces?
Tabs or spaces. I started out with tabs because that's the way that Unix was done. Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie used tabs. Everybody used tabs. There was no notion of spaces. And this was partly the minimalism and why type four characters when you could type one. But the problem is that things tend to get wide after a while, and especially with a language like Java, which is intrinsically wide, I think spaces are a better fit for most people. And so I think now when I'm writing my own code, I mostly use spaces, and every once in a while I get bitten because there's a tab when there should have been a space, or vice versa. Some languages, in particular Go, enforce a standard format period, and the standard format uses tabs, and that's it. But you can display the tabs as any number of spaces so that the visual effect is right.
Sinful would like to know what you're involved in now, innovations or recreational? Comp sci.
I'm glad you qualified it, because recreational, my wife and I are on vacation in England and having a wonderful time. Thank you. Technically, at the moment, I am trying to gear up for a class in the fall, where I'm going back after a several-year layoff to the class that I've been teaching for non-technical people. And I did that for a long time, probably 15 years or more. I can put in a plug for the book called Understanding the Digital World. Please buy many copies for yourself and your friends. I had a three-year layoff on that, and so I'm back to doing that in the fall. And of course, the world changes, and so there are things that I didn't cover properly, I think, or enough in previous go-arounds that I want to include this time. The obvious things are things related to machine learning, big data, natural language processing, and so on. What is all of that stuff? How do you explain that for people who are not technical, but are probably going to be making decisions on behalf of those who are technical? And so that's one of the things that I'm worrying about at the moment. The other thing that I've been playing with off and on in a really as a dilettante is issues in and around the digital humanities. We had talked earlier about how computing spreads into lots and lots of different areas. So digital humanities is basically doing with computer the kinds of things of analyzing data and drawing inferences from it and making it available to other people and so on that you do with any other kind of data. But the data comes from really, really interesting sources, often somewhat elderly. This goes back to my interest in history. And so I have been, over the last couple of years, I had run computer science seminars, that is seminars for computer science students who were doing independent work in digital humanities, studying data sets from all kinds of weird things. And I'm, in addition, supervising independent work one semester and senior thesis work for undergraduates on digital humanities. And so I keep going on that, but very much as a dilettante. I could talk for a long time about it, but it would become obvious that I didn't know what I was talking about. So that would be fine. And so that's another aspect. And of course, the same kinds of things about machine learning and natural language processing and so on show up very much in digital humanity. There's a wonderful thing here in England. It's called oldbaileyonline.org, and it's basically some university consortium, I guess, digitized all of the records of the Old Bailey from the late 1600s until the early 1900s. These had been court records, right? Transcriptions had been taken from, as I say, the late 1600s right into the early 1900s, and they were all digitized, put together in XML format, and now you can search them and find out things like, well, there was probably some guy named Sean Riley in the 1700s who was hanged for stealing a pig or something like that. It's just absolutely a wonderful, amazing database. It's close to 200,000 cases, very carefully documented with the names of the perps and the victims and the witnesses and the judges and what happened to the people when they were convicted. One of the things I had not realized until I saw this was, you've heard of transportation. You know, if you'd done something bad, you were transported. And of course, everybody thinks transportation meant Australia. No, transportation before 1776 meant you were shipped off to the United States, which wasn't the United States at that point, it was just the colonies. And that might explain all kinds of things.
An atomic diameter or so, and then you move it across the surface. And what you're picking up on is the interaction of that atom right at the end of the tip with the atoms at the surface. So you move back and forth and build up an image. That